This episode of Cue the Podcast is brought to you in part by Oga's Cantina. That's right, folks. It's Oga's Cantina, the one spot at Disneyland where you can actually buy alcohol. But don't expect to walk away with more than a mild buzz, because Oga's Cantina has a 2-drink limit. Oga's Cantina, come here for, in my humble opinion, relatively gross, pre-mixed, slushy-style, bastardized takes on margaritas, grasshoppers, vodka drinks, and more, including a $46 Mai Tai. I'm not kidding. You literally can't buy it without the mug. But you know what? Oga's Cantina has Captain Rex. So 10 out of 10, come on down to Oga's Cantina today at Disneyland, California. Greetings, fellow armchair Imagineers. Tiki here.
And Blue Dragon 5.
And I know this is probably your first podcast specifically about the Star Tours queue, and it's mine too. It's time to cue
the podcast.
All right, that's right, Dragon. That's right. We are back here on Cue the Podcast. We are talking about one of your personal favorites. It is Star Tours.
Nothing but Star Tours.
We're going to be kind of blending a little bit of both worlds with this queue. We're going to be talking about kind of the history of the ride, where we'll be getting into the original Star Tours queue, and then we'll transition into the proper Cue the Podcast format, kind of going room for room through the queue. And we'll do that through the, the current iteration, the Adventure Continues model. So, Dragon, let's start with the nostalgia we have for the original Star Tours. And, man, I certainly have a bunch of it myself. Of course, I think one of the things that a bunch of 90s kids who grew up with this VHS tape can remember is Disneyland Fun. We had the Zippity-Doo-Dah segment. And it doesn't last very long, but I'll definitely insert it into the episode in post-production. We have a little flash of, like, Star Tours, and we see C-3PO and R2-D2 at the Star Speeder. We see Captain Rex. We see the film footage of the Star Speeder going into light speed on the ride. And it's just enough to entice you, like, oh, man, what the hell's going on? You know, it really... Dragon, this is going to sound silly, but it felt like a big kid ride. That's the best way I can describe it. You know what I mean? I was like, oh man, this is serious stuff here.
Quote Cosgrove from Freakazoid, big guy stuff.
And Draken, just overall my opinion on the original Star Tours is I honestly think it's the quintessential something goes wrong theme park attraction. I don't think that there's ever been a better something goes wrong narrative than the one that we got in the original Star Tours. I think, was the film a little dated? Sure. Did it get a little repetitive? Yeah, absolutely. Every ride gets repetitive the more you go on it. But I don't know. There's just something so endearing about having Captain Rex as, you know, I mean, let's face it, give it up to Captain Rex right now. He's probably one of the best theme park characters that's ever been created. And to me, he's like exists almost exclusively like he is in Star Wars canon, but you know, he's very much a Disneyland creation first and foremost. And so I don't know. I really think that the narrative of this attraction, the whole like the wayward pilot on his first flight and he wants to do a good job and everything's going wrong. And I mean, it's kind of perfect, Dragon. It really is. I think the only competition it has in the something goes wrong department in terms of a perfect narrative structure, I think, is the original Jurassic Park ride. But I would still give the edge to this just because this has the character arc that the Jurassic Park ride doesn't. Like, this has all the pitfalls and peril that the Jurassic Park ride does, but it also has that lovable Captain Rex character, and that kind of gives it the Disney edge.
I'd agree with that.
All right, what's your nostalgia?
So I love Star Tours so much. I do. I think it's always been kind of a staple of Hollywood Studios. It really put the Hollywood in Hollywood Studios back in the day, you know. Even before it was Hollywood Studios, even it was MGM, it was like one of the big draws. You know, it'd be like, okay, well, like we have the great movie ride this way, we have Star Tours this way, and across from Star Tours, we have the Indiana Jones attraction. Like it's all gold from here, man. It's all, and of course, you know, down the ways a little bit, you have the Muppets. It's all great, it really is. You know, it was very much like, you know, at the time it was kind of a kid's chance back then to be in Star Wars. Of course, now there's like a whole theme park for that called. called Galaxy's Edge. There's like a whole section of theme park with Galaxy's Edge, but yeah, still, this was like the biggest chance you had, like the walk in the Millennium Falcon before the kids could actually walk in the Millennium Falcon or something close to it.
Right.
You know? I mean, I love simulator rides, and this is a big reason why this experience, and I absolutely echo your earlier sentiments, Tiki. I love the old adage of like something goes wrong on the ride and you're just kind of along for the crazy ride that follows. Of course, it's kind of a big thing. I think this probably being the original example of it for me, if I'm really reaching all the way back. I mean, it's an immersive.
It's the earliest example I can think of a something goes wrong arc. I mean, I'm sure Universal Studios has done like, you know, on their tram tour and stuff, things quote unquote go wrong on the tram tour. That's the only other example I can really think of. But this is the first one to really turn it into a full blown narrative.
Exactly. I mean, this is like this is the simulator equivalent of it, where before that you probably had the great movie ride, which something goes wrong during the tour. It's kind of at least, I don't know if great movie ride
is
always.
But great movie ride is, I mean, the difference between that and Star Tours is that the something goes wrong element isn't exactly like a main fixture of the great movie ride. It's more of a detour.
True. Anyway, so that thing. So Star Tours, you know, it's an immersive, wild ride. It has an ingenious concept of using the real estate of a galaxy far, far away, as in like, okay, so if you're in Star Wars, what are you going to do for fun when you're in the Star Wars universe? Well, I mean, you can go on a tour, and a tour in this case means you can go to different planets. That's really neat. And you kind of get into this really great a lot of really great creative ingenuity. I'm like, okay, so there's like an airport in Star Wars, essentially, and that kind of takes you places, and it's kind of a really great destination spot using that excellent real estate. So I've always just been kind of fascinated by the attraction. I think over the years they've gotten more ambitious with, in some cases it's kind of been for the better, in some cases they've been just trying to be a little kind of trendy with things now. I mean, the older ride I think has quite a simplicity to it, but of course over the years there are great things that gleam from each reinvention. Of course, it's kind of a shame we can't blend them all together properly, and it seems like we did that once and then we've kind of drifted off from that into a little bit more of a commercial space, if you will. But seriously, Star Tours, I got nothing nice thing to say about Star Tours, man. I got a lot of love for it.
What good is sightseeing if you never get to see the sights? Other companies tour you so fast, it's all a blur. But on Star Tours, you'll never miss a thing. Introducing the IC360 Intelligent Camera System, available exclusively on all Star Tours flights. Our cam droids place you nose to nose with the galaxy's most dangerous creatures, take you out into the most extreme climates, and put you right in the middle of the action. And you'll see it all for the comfort and convenience of your Star Speeder seat. So no matter what your destination, experience the IC360 sensation. It's the scenic way to see the galaxy, and it's only on Star Tours.
Kind of start with the exteriors, and Dragon's is going to kind of differ between coasts for us, so this is kind of an interesting compare and contrast. And I honestly think both exteriors have their ups and their downs. The Tomorrowland exterior, I really like the fact that is like very prominent in the main kind of causeway of Tomorrowland. It's kind of the first thing you see on the corner of Main Street. You've got that big electrical tower there. And I really like how the room itself sort of looks in on the Star Speeder and 3PO. So we've been passing by on the street, you kind of get like, oh, what's in there? I want to go in there. And in Hollywood Studios, I like how the exterior is a little bit more hidden by the indoor forest, and you have the AT-ATs kind of looming overhead as you go in, and it's a little bit more understated.
I tell you, man, I got so much love for the exterior of my attraction. You know, like mine, the sense that I own it, but mine, the sense of we both have our own personalized versions of it, man. You know, you have yours that you've kind of had more time with, and of course the one I've just been with, you know, freak. Every time I've been on Star Tours, it's been the same. It's been that same exterior from the old ride to the new ride. It's always just been there. Just the, you know, the indoor atmosphere of it all. Just the scale. You walk right under the AT-AT. You have like some speeder bikes on the outside. And of course, one of the happiest memories I have with Star Tours is, I believe the last time I rode it, like after they, you know, they revamped it, basically the whole randomizer appeal of the ride. I basically, of course, the big appeal, you can ride it multiple times. You can count some different variations on it. And I just hit it just right, where early in the day it had been a little rainy, so as it tends to do in Florida, you know, sometimes you get some sporadic rain coming. And the first round is like, you know, sometimes you hit it where it rains, but it's not pouring, where it's just kind of like misty in the atmosphere, and especially...
Oh, yeah.
And you're just kind of there, and you're literally on the forest moon of Endor, as if like a rainforest in space, and you're just kind of there in line waiting. And then later, of course, it's night. It's like basically like the last ride you're going to hit, and you hit the ride, and basically you're going out with a bang in Hollywood Studios, where it's like you go on the ride, it's like, oh boy, that was fun, and oh my god, there's no line, let's do it again. You do it again a couple times, and with just all of that, it's just one of the happiest experiences I've had on Star Tours, you know, man.
Greg, I live for Disney moments like that. I really do. That's like moments like you just described are kind of like the reason why I still go to Disney routinely as a grown-ass man.
And that's when they just had got, that was like when the randomizer was new and they knew it, they could keep it straight, you know, there wasn't like all this like, you know, mixture and everything. I don't know if it was just when I went on or if like this before like things started to get complicated and it was before we had
things
like,
got complicated as the movies started coming out.
That's what I'm saying. I think it was before that. I'm pretty sure it was way before that point, because the last time I went to, from what I can recall, was 2012, at least a little before.
And Force Awakens was 2015.
Exactly. So I'm pretty sure it's like when they like
really start to get bad until we had like scenes from both Force Awakens and The Last Jedi in there. Exactly. That's when things really kind of took a turn for the worst.
Exactly. So basically it was kind of like the time when the idea of like, let's kind of like broaden the horizons was really kind of firing on all cylinders, you know?
Right.
Okay.
Okay, so Dragon, you mentioned the overflow queues. Let's talk about it. We already kind of mentioned how good yours is with the, you know, especially if you catch it at the right time with the fog and everything and post-rain, the indoor forest setting, the AT-ATs over your head, the speeder bikes. Dragon, I would like you to describe my extended overflow queue, if you don't mind.
So Tiki has shown me the, because I'd never seen what the, so first of all, I was blissfully ignorant, because I always thought like, okay, the overflow queue, because again, the whole experience was that you're in the indoor forest, but I can also say, if you actually strike it right, I gotta tell you, those times I was actually in my overflow queue, I don't even think I needed to be in the overflow queue. It's basically walk the long route for the line, which, if there's no line, you can honestly just walk straight forward in there. But again, I assume you'll basically be going through like the loop of like the kind of the indoor forest where you see the speeder bike and all that sort of stuff. So I honestly just had that fun, that one experience I told you, but it's like, I didn't even need to go through that, but we did. So like, we kind of like ran through. It's like, yeah, it's fun. Yeah, it's, I don't know. Your overflow team, on the other hand, I pity your overflow team. The sad, pathetic thing I've ever seen in terms of
it
really is, especially in regards to Star Wars, because you basically go through thing, and I assume if it overflows, you're basically going to be in like some like upper level or something. Points you're going to be taken to this area.
No, it's not an upper level. It's literally like directly connected to the main building.
Sorry, I don't know why I keep thinking upper level, but yeah. Point being, you have this. It's just basically metal poles in the ground with chains on it, and here's the worst.
It's like vaguely prison like.
That's already sad. I mean, Tiki, when I'm at Universal, when I went on like, you know, the Nicktoon Blaster, I haven't, before they changed into the Despicable Me thing, like they have that there. But the good news is they have like a banner, and they have like, you know, like little televisions that play Nicktoons for you. At least there's it's Nicktoons.
Right.
Unfortunately, you, my friend, you look up. You're not seeing Star Wars. You're seeing a solar system, not like a good like galactic solar system. You're not seeing Hoth and Jakku from like a wide view. No. You just have like a plain Jane solar system, man. You're talking like eighth grade. Like you're talking like not even eighth grade science. I'm talking like fifth grade science, man.
Right. Oh man.
That's what you're
on top of that. There's we have the paintings of not Star Wars planets. Oh no, just generic sci-fi planets.
That's what I mean. Just literal. Just it's so sad. Just you look up and it's like, oh guys, look at
this solar system. It's just like, what happened? Like, why? If we needed to have this extra room, why couldn't we just theme it to, like, I don't know, like an employee break room or something? How cool would that be? You know what I mean? Like the Star Tours break room.
Yeah.
I don't know. Something like connected to this. Like it is honestly one of, like, Dragon, I refuse to wait in that room. If the queue is like, I will either grab a fast pass or just skip it entirely if the queue goes in there. I have never once waited in that room, and I don't ever intend to.
It's quite
it's that pathetic. Oppressive.
It really is. It's quite pathetic.
But then, after we go into that overflow queue at Disneyland, we get to the good stuff, Dragon. We get to the good stuff. Now, you mentioned the Endor Forest being the part where you just like to linger and you don't even necessarily have to go through it. And Dragon, the last few times I've been to Disneyland, like, really, the line for Star Tours has been non-existent, sadly. And, but honestly, I really just like to linger in that opening room with the Star Speeder for the reason that you mentioned earlier, which is just that C-3PO is kind of just, like, reacting to everything, and just that loop of him and R2 arguing, it's just, it's got such a great atmosphere to it. And, go ahead.
We're fine. So we're in the spaceport, essentially, right? We're in the big room. Oh, okay, I tell you, dude, I love the star. I love me a good ride vehicle. I do. Cool, man. I love a good
I
ride
really,
vehicle.
Really think it's cool that that we have the ride vehicle, like, on display. Like, it's one of those things where it's like, oh, we're going to get in one of those things. You know what I mean? It builds anticipation so much.
It's approximately, I know it's not the exact same scale of the simulator, basically it's painting a picture. This essentially is what you're getting into, like a two-scale spaceship. Isn't it awesome? And then they have C-3PO and R2-D2 bantering, as I believe R2's being lowered into the... Essentially, R2's your other pilot in this. I know they've done that for the new version. I think, I don't know if it's always been the case, but I think...
R2 was the co-pilot in the other one, yeah.
Good. So, of course, we have two versions of the Star Speeder. They originally have, like, the white and blue version, which looks very ILM model-y, which is really cool. And you have the new version, which essentially is the same thing, only it's, like, kind of this sienna brown and white with the 3000. I like that we've, you know, given the 1000 and 3000. No, actually, wait a minute. I think the original was the 3000, and the new one's the 1000, if I got that right. Point being, you have a 1,000 and 3,000. Same point being, it's a really great looking vehicle. It's just great to see all in scale there, and of course, when you walk in there, we're talking about C-3PO, R2-D2, and the speeder, which is great in itself. But let's talk about what's going on upstairs.
Yes. Upstairs, there's like two or three Mod Calamari mining the controls, and Dragon. One of them's got to be Ackbar, right? One of them's got to be Ackbar.
Yeah, well, again, assuming the war is over, which again, I know there's kind of there's a conflict within that statement because we kind of see the battle unfold before our eyes. But let's just entertain the notion for a second here. Ackbar, you know, he's got to be doing something after the war. I mean, you know, he's got to do something before Force Awakens.
You know what,
Dragon?
You know? I feel like you know, like runway security is a good job for Ackbar because he can basically just warn people if the runway is backed up, because the runway being backed up would be a trap.
Yep, one could say.
That was really forced.
You know what Admiral Ackbar's favorite TV show is?
Trapped? I don't know.
The 60s Batman, because of all the death traps.
Oh, God.
Every time at the end of the first episode, he can always say, it's a trap!
Oh, my God, that's great. That's great. Yes. That's clever, Dragon. That's clever.
There you go. Okay, let's.
Do you know what? Do you know Admiral Akbar's favorite rap song is?
I think I do.
Trapped in the closet.
Yep. Right, there's a certain documentary we should show Admiral Akbar, but let's say. Okay, get back into it again. So now we're kind of in the adventures continue kind of space of things here. So let's, we start about our new mascot. So again, so Captain Rex, he's kind of in his infancy here, literally. He's kind of out of the box being worked on. So who is kind of our main mascot of things here? Like, who's our, who's kind of our stewardess and spokesperson of the ride?
The Allison Janie bot.
Yes. Allison San, or I forget if they just called her Allison Jan. I could have sworn it's Allison San, I think. Point being, we have our stewardess bot, who very much, and this is a really clever thing. Again, if you're in the prequels, I love that we took the waitress bot from the diner in episode 2. It's one of the most boring Star Wars movies you're ever going to watch, kids. I'll warn you that right now.
It does not hold up at all. I don't care what people say about the nostalgia for the prequels.
The best defense I keep hearing for episode 2 is like, well, the ending, you know, they're about to be fed to the...
The ending is the most boring part. The ending is just CGI noise.
That's what I'm saying. Like, hey, C-3PO, get
like, at least the other parts have, like, amusingly bad acting.
Yeah. Anyway, point being, of course, we go to the diner for some reason, because Obi-Wan knows a guy, pretty much. And anyway, in that diner, we have,
Dexter.
Yep, we have that, and of course, Dexter has the robot waitresses, and the idea is, like, I assume we've repurposed some of the waitresses for kind of steward, to become stewardesses for the ride, which, of course,
includes
Allison Janney's. And, I gotta tell you, I do like the uniformity. Again, that's what I'm talking about. I love the uniformity and the idea, like, when Star Tours is operating at peak efficiency, this is what they had going on. They had, like, a really tight ship, a really good operation. Where, again, the idea is that the ride would run smoothly until something goes wrong with the pilot, which, again, it wouldn't happen within itself in Captain Rex until years later, so we have something different happen. We'll get to that when we get to the pre-show.
Well, technically, something does still go wrong with the pilot, yeah.
I know, that's what I'm saying. Something still goes wrong, but it's not, like, you know, within, like, we approved this pilot.
Right. Okay, we get to the, we get to the cargo bay. You already discussed Rex kind of being there, like, literally, like, fresh out of the box.
Literally, you turn the corner into the cargo bay, there's Rex. It's kind of like a blink and you miss a cameo. If you stick around, it's like, oh, hey, there's Rex. Especially if you know who that is. Like, oh, my God, it's Rex, but he's, oh, my God, it's Rex. Either in his infancy or he's, like, he's being repaired. Again, either way, you can look at it as, like, it's, you know, like, hey, I'm checking in with our old buddy, or it's like, oh, look, it's for the first time.
So the cargo bay is, unfortunately, I think, a room that I don't like as much as in the original iteration. You remember the conveyor belt that was in the original iteration?
I believe so, yes.
And that is just completely gone, and that is a shame, because the conveyor belt just gave this room such a level of kinetic energy.
It did. However, there's one thing I do got to say, though. I kind of like the cargo bay more upon the revamp, because we've had a lot more comedy with kind of our G2 droids here. The G2 droids, which I believe, assuming they've used the same model they originally had. Remember the special story about those G2 droids? Remember what they're from originally?
Yes, of course I remember, Dragon. They are from America Sings. They're like the few America Sings animatronics that didn't end up in Splash Mountain.
Because Disney Imagineering believes in that old Brad Bird Indian philosophy, the old Native American philosophy, the old adage of, we use every part of the buffalo. In this case, we literally skin the animatronics and we use them in other rides. We literally use every part of the buffalo.
All right. This is a good comedy duo for sure. Of course, one of them being Patrick Warburton, a master of Disney theme park cues.
We have the luggage G2 droid, and the luggage one I think is my favorite because it basically scans a luggage and you have like some fun Easter eggs in there, just like some fun comedy, and especially if you're in a long line, this guy's giving you the most comedy while you're waiting in the cargo bay. Because my favorite thing, I've never been able to find like a POV or like a ride video ever, because I've only saw it once in person. It delighted me to no end, the fact that when he scanned one of the items, Buzz Lightyear was in a suitcase. Buzz Lightyear was in a Star Wars attraction, and of course, then it gets even better if you realize that the other droid, the security droid up top, they're the ones scanning the people. That's Patrick Warburton, who voiced Buzz Lightyear in Buzz Lightyear Star Command. It's like two Buzz Easter eggs for the price of one. Awesome. So a big update we should talk about is that we then are told to grab our 3D glasses or our flight glasses.
Yeah, and I gotta tell you, Dragon, this is one of those attractions that actually uses 3D pretty well. I'll give you a good example of that. In the crate sequence is actually, like, you know, in spite of the cynical marketing behind why it's there, it's a good sequence, especially for the 3D, because we get that iconic red sand, or the red salt. Kind of like, there's the sequence where the windshield just gets covered in the red salt. And that is where the 3D just gets really effective. You know, when stuff is covering the windshield, when we have these moments of, you know, where the vision is obscured by things going on, that's where the 3D is really effective. And I think that it's underplayed 3D, and I really like that. It's not like, you know, it doesn't resort to cheap 3D tricks. All right. Okay, so yeah, we have the waiting terminal, Dragon, and I know you love those numbers.
I do. So we enter the pre-show kind of waiting area here, folks, and I gotta tell you, like, there, it's gonna sound so silly, so ridiculous, but I just love the I love the numbers outside. Basically, when you're being grouped off, like put into like rows for the ride outside the doors, as well, they have like these numbers on the floors. That just seems so, I don't know why, it just seems like organized. Like, man, you're waiting with anticipation. You got your numbers there. It's like you're so close. Like you're another step closer to being on the ride, and you're sort of all organized. I don't know. I know many rides have it, but you know what? Yeah, it's like a nice little touch.
All right, so. You know, it's interesting because the original Star Tour is basically the only footage that we had before the safety video was just like, okay, we're seeing the Star Speeder get loaded up and prepared, and it was honestly pretty boring. And here we get something, you know, we get the Alice and Janie bot kind of talking to us throughout the wait, not just the safety video.
Yeah, we still have a little bit of the cam footage, though. Like, they have like the
droids
from episode one there. But you're right, that we have more of the Alice and Janie bot.
So I think that is an improvement. And Dragon, I will say, the one thing that I was really hoping that they were going to keep was Chewbacca getting pissed off at the flash photo. Dragon, I cannot tell you how infinitely amusing I found that in the original Star Tours. Just the little kid like turning directly to Chewbacca and Chewbacca just freaking out about it.
What kills me is the fact that not only did they just keep that bit, Tiki, they took the whole safety video from the original, but they updated and they made it even better. Like, they put everyone in costume, they're all going in there. I love, like, the whole, you know, you move down all the way around, you stow your cargo, one of my favorite parts, stow in the cargo, you click the belt, and then we have the flash photography gag. They got rid of the smoke. There was actually a PS to the safety video they didn't bring back for a reason, because C-3PO gave that PS, and of course, obviously, C-3PO does other stuff we're going to get to in a hot minute here, but I love that, he was like an alien who was taking a picture like an old school Polaroid camera, I guess, and smoking at the same time, and they got rid of that.
Like, oh, yeah, I remember that.
The three-eyed alien, but, you know, basically we still have Chewie and essentially Ackbar. Even if Ackbar is not the Mon Calamari earlier, maybe it's like Ackbar is going with Chewie for like a holiday or something. Like, just Chewie and Ackbar is kind of on the side going on vacation or something. So, you know, the point is, like, they're behind the kid who takes the picture, and we still keep getting ticked off. It's like, ah, no flash with them. It's really great.
Dragon, I think that there should be, like, specifically on Pirates of the Caribbean, because Pirates of the Caribbean is the ride where it happens the most frequently. They should literally just have a guy in a Chewbacca suit on every boat that goes through Pirates of the Caribbean. And he can just freak out at whoever flashes a photo. Because, Dragon, it's a reoccurring thing whenever I go on that ride.
I gotta be honest, man. How great would that be, though? Just all the... If they, that, wouldn't that be great marketing if you said Chewbacca as, like, kind of your mascot into the other Disney rides? Just to advertise, okay, Star Wars is at Disney. How are you sure that? Well, okay, we have Chewbacca's going on the rides.
It doesn't even have to... They don't all have to be Chewbacca. Just have just generic Wookiees.
Sure, sure. Yeah,
and just promote the theme that Wookiees do not like flash photos.
A little bit of that, maybe the C-3PO. Sorry, based on some of the droids too. Like if you wanted to like a don't litter in Disney, that sort of thing. Like don't throw your garbage, leave your garbage around. Like R2 just like being mistaken for a trash can or something.
Oh God!
Like he wasn't Jedi, you know, something like that.
Oh man.
Anyways, of course, let's talk about my favorite part of the revamp of the whole thing. My favorite detail. I mean, as much as we love Captain Rex, and I still got a lot of fondness and respect for Captain Rex, as we all do. But I tell you, my favorite idea in the whole reconceptualization of the ride. I think the most ingenious idea is what we did C-3PO during this pre-show, where C-3PO, you know, as we've always established, C-3PO is around during the ride. He is. What we've done this time is that C-3PO, he is essentially, he's a systems analyst, and he's going to check the ride before he's going to clear the ride. He's going to clear the star speeder before it goes out the station.
Uh-huh.
So it goes in there, and you have kind of your standard issue pilot. Basically, C-3PO tells him to shoo, because we got to go off, we got to blast off in 2 minutes here. Shoo, I have to get in there, do my systems check, and C-3PO, per his clumsiness, pours like that sort of Empire Strikes Back sort of thing. C-3PO wanders into the wrong room and gets his head blown off, that sort of thing. Where it's like, oh no, basically the whole cockpit just kind of closes in on him, and of course, so once you get in there, he's going to be there in waiting for it. I think that's such an ingenious idea, and making C-3PO the pilot is a brilliant call. And it's like, yes, that's how you... C-3PO is a character who... We see him so few times do we ever see C-3PO really in the thick of the action. We give him an excuse, this endearing character that you may have an attachment to. You put him in the thick of the action, and it makes sense. I mean, as much as great as Captain Rex is, again, he's a new character where you have kind of the pre-established character. You have all the history and, you know, the attachment to with him. He's in, you know, in every movie. You know, we have C-3PO kind of like thrown in as kind of our totem into the Star Tours experience. It's just a great idea. We're using an icon as our way into the experience. It's a really good idea.
sure. Yeah, it really works. Okay, so Dragon, my personal favorite moment in all of Star Tours is not anything on the film itself, but it's always been that moment when the doors open and you see the star speeder, mm-hmm. the full-size star speeder, and you walk into it, Dragon. I will never get tired of that. That's such
that scale,
awesome
man.
Transition.
That scale, it's so trippy. Again, you see that scale from the earlier display room, and then you're going in like, oh god, we're gonna walk into the room. And I know you're talking because you're standing on those numbers. Those doors open, you get a look uh-huh. inside. The
go spark. Over like the tiny little bridge.
Mm-hmm. Like as if you're getting on a plane. It's like, oh god, it's like the travel experience done right. It's like the travel of the future at your feet, man. You take a step in, you go, you walk in, you walk down the row, you all move all the way down, you sit, you buckle up, and then...
Bumpy flight, and who knows where we'll land? The freezing cold of Hoth, the sandstorms of Tatooine.
Or get blasted to bits by the Empire.
What? Are you scared?
No. Really? Because you look scared.
With more than 50 different adventures, you never know where you'll go. Star Tours new in 3D, part of a sensational summer at the Disneyland Resort.
Ooh, somebody's got eyes for you.
Oh, shoot. That's all the time we have for today, folks. Sorry about that.
John Luck.
Jesus. Ah.
Well, you know what? While we're here, let's swing by the gift shop on our way out.
All right, let's exit through the gift shop. Okay, so yeah, we have Star Traders, and then we also have Tatooine Traders, right?
Yes.
All right. Star Traders is, I would dare to say Star Traders is an iconic Disneyland shop, Dragon. It's been there since before Star Tours opened. And that flying saucer that's over the cash register, that's been there for a long time. also iconic is the 80s neon Mickey Mouse astronaut lights outside of the shop. So there's a lot of classic Disneyland going on. Like, I mean, truth be told, it's probably the most classic Tomorrowland thing left in Tomorrowland, if I'm being honest. And the merchandise is okay. You know, you got the prototype of the Build a Lightsaber that's just cheap plastic and not nearly as immersive. You've got, of course, pins and t-shirts for Star Wars as far as the eye can see. You've got the photo booth where you can insert yourself into various Star Wars scenarios. That's always cool. Tatooine Trader is striking. I imagine it's a little bit more because, of course, Star Traders is a little homogenized. You know, it's kind of like it's Star Wars, but also all Disney. I imagine Tatooine Traders does a little bit better of a job of making it feel like a Star Wars shop first and foremost.
I would say so. So, of course, this is going to sound so simplistic, especially to the really, you know, the deep cut guys. Like, they go to rides like there's no tomorrow. Boy, it's like I love the idea of the gift shop being built into the exit of the ride. I mean, I know it's very just synergistic of like, of course, buy some stuff on the way out. I know there's that, but I still feel like the optimistic way is like, you know, we're walking in, there's like, you're rewarded for the harrowing experience you went on, or the fun that you had. It's like, hey, a little kind of pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. It's like, hey. You know, it's like a little treat at the end of the ride. Like, hey, you survived this ordeal. You know, like, you know, went through all this stuff. We almost died a couple times during the ride. Like, hey, stuff. You know, it's kind of nice. It's kind of a safe little environment at the end of the ride. It's like a cushy, like, little, like, hey, we're all safe now.
I think the best ones are the ones that thematically actually tie in and have a canonical reason to be there.
Yeah.
And so, let's see, like, good examples of that would be, like, Jurassic Park, the ride has, of course, there is a gift shop in Jurassic Park, and
yep. You go
into one.
That's a good one.
Let's see, you have, I'm blanking on it, I had a good one. Small World has a toy shop, which I just, you know, not necessarily canonical, but
No, but it makes sense, you know, all the
very appropriate and charming.
Yeah.
Any others you can think of that very... Oh, Tower of Terror is the big one, I think.
There you go.
Because Tower of Terror, of course, the hotel lobby has a gift shop.
Right.
So, yeah, there's not many examples of that, but when it's done right, it does feel seamless.
What's great here, I mean, location-wise, maybe not 100%, but what's a great thing about Tatooine Traders that kind of has a little over Star Traders from the sounds of things is that... You know, you're in a building that feels very, it's designed to be on Tatooine, that's like a carved structure, like on a sand, like kind of like a sandy, you know, kind of a desert planet, kind of like Tatooine, you know? It's, you know, it looks really carved out off of Tatooine, like a place you'd walk into, like a very cantina-esque without a cantina, like another location that's not as celebrated and iconic, it gets its own version of another Star Wars sex of places. My favorite item in the whole in Tatooine Trails, of course, Traders is the Star Speeder. I love how they have like the little they sell versions of the Star Speeder because me, I like to have ride vehicles if I can. Like I can't tell you like what I've gone through just looking for an 8-seater DeLorean. But you know,
question off air. I know
we have. But the Star Speeder though, I have last time the one I bought a little version of the Star Speeder because believe me, folks, they have like a full size version, but like a size you can put action figures into, like a bigger, you know, bigger size, like you kind of the like the die, like not a die cast, like let's say a 12. That's like a 12 footer, if you will.
Right.
Like a 12 inches, you know what I mean? Point being, I think 40 inches total for the thing. Point is, it's really big. And I would love to buy that. And believe me, they had it for the old ride. They had it for the new ride. They basically repainted it just like they did with the ride. It's like the ride vehicle itself. I would have loved to get it. Unfortunately, folks, if you travel and you don't trust the mailing system in regards to theme parks. In regards to, like, you know, when you mail something from a theme park and so and vice versa.
I trust the mailing system just in regards to, like, it's Disney themselves shipping it out, and I trust Disney.
Sure, but there's also a shipping charge as a whole.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean. My point is, Yeah, you go there. As much as I love to buy like the full version, we have like a C-3PO like driving the thing or a Captain Rex driving the thing. It looks really cool. Looks really awesome. I'm the guy who collects vehicles if I can. Might as well love to. You only have so much luggage space, which means you can't really bring it with you. So I got the small version of this. So I do have like a little totem from the last time I went during that really great experience. Like, man, it's like a little version of the Star Destroyer, a little R2-D2 poking out. It's so darn cool, man. So that's you have that going on for it. You have other items like the thing that always stuck out to me most is that I have like a personalized carbonite thing where basically you can freeze yourself in carbonite. Basically, they take like a picture of you and they customize you. Your face would be on this little figurine of you being frozen in carbonite. It's really neat.
Uh-huh.
They have one of those. They have some R2-D2 cups and mugs and pretty much what you said as well. Like, you know, you have like figures, pins, Legos, and also you have like build a lightsaber and build a droid. Not for the $200 that would cost in other Star Wars related places, but you know, kind of the prototype little kind of cutesy plasticky version of that. So yeah, pretty solid.
All right. And Dragon, you survived. Cue the podcast. How do you feel?
Like, I want to go to the gift shop again. No, I feel pretty good.
Okay. So next week, folks, we are going to keep the Star Wars run-in, and we are going to be taking a look at one of my new personal favorite theme park queues. It is the queue for Millennium Falcon Smuggler's Run. Dragon, I believe that if you've listened to stuff like our Trip Report podcast, it's a queue that we've talked about before. All right, I'll be doing that one with Monkey, and honestly, I really think there's a lot of cool things about the Smuggler's Run queue. I really think that thing is like a well-oiled machine of creativity. So yeah, look for that soon, and thanks for watching, folks. Have a good night.
Bye-bye.
It's a thrill when you go downhill, 'cause you're riding on the mountain of your own free will, and you're zipping in a flash on a daring dash down a waterfall so rapid that you go splish splash. Splish, 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 splish,